few years, this skill will become more and more important to make money. More dealerships are becoming aware of the opportunities that we're here to talk about today. And as more dealerships join, the opportunity is going to diminish. And then it's going to diminish to the point where if you don't know how to be social like this, there's no more opportunity left for you. Because this prospect's already been hit by 9 people who do know this. Right now, we're the only ones that are really going to have this process dialed in, especially in Amarillo, not to my knowledge. So the reason I say that is it's good that you're new. And it's good that you've been here a long time because you know the business. But it's also good to not learn any bad habits. And just because something worked well 4 years ago does not mean that it's going to work the same way 4 years from now. So now's the perfect time for you to get in and learn what's going to work in the next 4 years and start now. And the reason that that matters is video is one of the very few things that you get incredibly better at every single time you do it. So I've worked on learning new Phil Felt Found closes and, you know, picked up Grant Cardone's Learn 1000 Closes workbook, you know what I mean? But when you fire a close off at somebody, maybe they buy the car, maybe they don't, but you don't observe yourself doing the close. So you don't actually improve necessarily at that particular close, right? When you make a video, if that video is terrible or awesome, the next one you make will be better. It's a weird process. You force yourself, and this is the part that makes people want to avoid video, to watch yourself. I don't like the way my hair looks. I don't like the way I stutter. I don't like the way I look a little cross-eyed. I didn't know my left eye was lower, right? Whatever it is, it forces you to look at it and be aware of it. And that's why you don't want to do the videos in the first place, or why a lot of people don't, right? But what it means is you get to instantly look at what you did and look at how it could be better. And just having our human brains kick on to that problem, you instantly will improve the videos. A couple things will happen. Your shots will be better. What you say will start to sound more like how you talk when you leave a voicemail, because your nerves don't get up when you're in front of the camera, you know what I mean? And then the most important thing that'll happen is you just learn to get a level of comfort with video so that it doesn't feel like something important is happening. If somebody comes on my wall and argues with me on Facebook about some tax position or whatever, like, I'm not in a position in my life to sit there and type them 3 paragraphs. It's just so intuitive for me now. I'm like, oh yeah, well here's the thing about that, buddy. You know what I mean? I go straight for the video response on Facebook, everywhere, because I've lowered the amount of stress that it creates to create a video. You see what I mean? So that's my biggest goal for you guys, is to understand that when we talk about videos, we are not talking about videos. We're talking about human faces. There's only 3 things that make a car sales or a salesperson money: eyebrows, lips, eyes. That's our storyteller. This face right here. Are you telling me? As much as, no more than, come here, check it out. Right? All the influence that we have over the customer is our tone of voice, our voice inflection, their ability to get a read on us and decide if we're trustworthy or not. And I'm sure people have looked at me and were like, he's not trustworthy. I can't control what they think, but this is the game, right? This is how you influence somebody. Tone of voice, body language, voice inflection, stuff like that. Video relays all of those things. So this is not about saying, hey, I want to do a video and it's going to save me. A video isn't like a ringtone. A video is just a medium that allows you to put your face, your facial expressions, your excitement, your enthusiasm, whatever it might be, in front of a customer who's not here. So the only thing, I've been in, you know, I've grabbed ups for a decade, I've been on your guys' side of the business, and it's a beautiful business except for when you're waiting to talk to a customer. I mean, not having somebody in front of you is like the only part that sucks, right? So video, when you get it down and you learn some of these ways to send it out to people, you'll learn is a really effective way to prospect. You can come in one day and go, we'll make a little prospecting video, guys, just a reminder, $200 bird dog. If you got that bill out there, if you know somebody, send them my way, tell me their name, send me their cell phone, I'll contact them. And you can make that video one time and sit and send it to 100 people in a day. You know what I mean? That's easier for me than actual prospecting, right? That's a much simpler, much more consolidated process. And everybody who gets that video is going to be emotionally impacted by the fact because they think you made it for them, right? So anyways, that's a really, really important part to understand, is that we need to know how to get the videos out to people, we need to know when to get the videos out to people, and you need to see it as getting your influence out to them. How can I get my hands on this person? How can I talk to them? How can I get them to respond back to me, okay? So what we're going to talk about on these slides is just it's a 5-step thing. All it is about how to not screw it up. It's really what this is about. It's how to create decent quality content that you can send to a customer or use as an ad with just a cell phone. Okay? All dealerships have some things in common that make this really easy to do. Skateboard shops, you might need lights and some other things, but I'll show you where there's some tricks here to getting around a car dealership really quickly, really easily, and create some really good stuff. So, my wife is our prop model for this one. So a lot of these shots you're going to see look bad because they're designed to show you what not to do. So we're going to talk about good versus bad lighting, how to frame the shot, how to hold the phone steady and so that you're eliminating those shakes, how to avoid the audio mistakes that tend to plague a lot of videos. I made one today that had gusty wind and I got to go remake it, which is like number one. And then this is going to be the most important one, and that's how to talk and communicate while you're on a video in a three-act structure. And we'll get into what that actually means. So, bad versus good lighting. Not all lighting is equal, and not all bright rooms are good lighting. What you want is light that hits your face evenly, right? So we're going to talk about some of the things that I've seen people do that don't work. So first of all, this is a light meter. You don't need one of these, but you need to know what they do. So a light meter allows you to put like on your shirt, and it'll tell me that's how many lumens are like on your shirt. And then if you were in a different room, it'd be a different amount. You know, so you'll see these on like film sets because they want to know how bright is the background, how bright is the face, how bright is that, because they're recording it all at once, so they got to keep it balanced. So the message here is on your phone, you actually have what would function as a light meter. A light meter would tell you something's wrong, and then you would adjust the camera to fix it, right? So a lot of people don't know this, but when you see this little square on your phone, that both pulls what you point to in sharper focus, so that it's focused on that, not behind them or in front of them, but right on them. And it also meters the light. So if you watch, if I touch that, you see how dark this gets? And if I touch this, you see how it brightens it up? So it's actually using a light meter light function. It's built into all of our phones, and you just touch the person's face before you start recording, and it'll balance that person so that they won't be too bright or too dark, right? So this is where having balance within the entire shot matters. If you're in the shade, and I'm filming you, but behind you is dead beating sun, then there's no way to put you and that sun in the same shot at the same time. Either you're gonna be dark and the sun's gonna be normal, or you're gonna be normal and the sun's gonna be, and behind you is gonna be too bright. See what I'm saying? So one of the only tricks is just trying to balance the light so that you don't end up in a situation like this where it's so bright behind her and she's not bright. And so in order to balance this shot, she ends up being a silhouette like this. And then the alternative would be this, where she's balanced, but the background is so bright that it's sort of obnoxious, right? So the trick is to ask yourself, where is my subject standing? How bright are they? And how bright is it behind them? So this is a really common mistake. People go to a room in a dealership they think is bright to do a video. You don't need bright light. You really just need the right directional light that hits your whole face evenly. And I'll show you how to get that. But what you definitely want to avoid when you're inside is this top-down light that just puts shadows underneath your eyes and ears. And if you think, in a dealership, all the lights are on the ceiling pointed down, right? So that's not good light. And it doesn't matter how bright it is, it'll never look good. And you notice also what it does to her colors to be under those lights. She looks very yellow, you know, compared to something like that, right? The next one is putting the sun into your subject's eyes, which is really common. People are like, look at how bright she is now. This is great. But if it results in them not being able to see, and it also results in these really harsh shadows, then not a good look, right? One of the tips, if you want to shoot outside in the sun, if you wait till 5 or 6 o'clock, it's called the golden hour. What people don't realize is, let's say you're outside, it's 5 o'clock, sun's up. It's half as bright as it was at noon. But your eyes have their own light meters built in, so you don't even realize that. Wherever you go as a human, it always looks, you know, about how it should. So you don't realize some points in the day are actually twice as bright as other points in the day because your eyes are adjusting for that. So the best time to shoot is at night when the light is kind of soft. They call it golden hour. It's kind of yellowy too, and it just gives everything a really beautiful look. So one of the ways you can kind of hack this process is to just wait until that golden hour. And you don't have to worry as much. Everything kind of just works out a little bit better. This is another one where another mistake people make is this right to left, where all the sun is over here and it's creating shadows on this side of her face. And so one of the tricks that I want to talk to you guys about here, which is maybe a little bit overkill, but see if I can get this on the video as well. So I made this video earlier. And do you see how well lit it is? Even though the sun is like banging outside. And so the way that I did that is when you go outside and you want to make a video outside, you hold your hand straight up in the air, okay? If the sun's coming in at this angle, then look on the ground and you'll see that your shadow kind of makes like a arrow. You know what I mean? So you follow me? Hold your hand up. If the sun's coming from behind you, you're going to see the line right out in front of you. You want to stand with that So what you've done is put the sun directly behind your head. That's basically just a simple way to figure out where, you know, do that without staring at the sun. But your whole goal is to create shade on your face by using your skull to block the sun, right? So now that's how you got that amazing looking shot, and it's out in the sun. So all these guys, and we'll do this when we leave this class, so go outside, everything you do looks horrible. It's terrible, right? But you'll find there's only like one 10 degree area, because if you stand this way too much, now I'm throwing shadows with my ears and everything else. But if you stand directly with the sun directly behind you, the shot will look amazing because your face is in shade, but it's also nice and bright. So this is what to do. Ever, all the other slides have been about what to avoid. So there's really only one trick that you need when you want to create a quality video. All dealerships have these giant, large panes of glass. And what that means is that even if it's a low light scenario, all that light is coming horizontally through the glass and on you. It's not above you, it's not beside you, it's not behind you, right? It's flooding straight horizontally, hits you right in the face. So this, you would look at this background and think, well, that's a hell of an opportunity, right? It doesn't look very exciting. But look at what it did. That's how she looked. This is her phone taking this shot. And that's this guy's, I'm learning something right now, face. Until he's taking it in. So this is exactly what you would want to have from a client. This is what it looks like, I said, coming from the other side. This is what it looks like actually on her phone. That's an amazing looking shot, right? You've never even seen your own face without shadows. If you think about it, you're brushing your teeth, there's shadows. You know what I mean? Every picture you've ever seen, there's shadows. There's something magical about seeing a face that's perfectly lit like this. And every single window you have in the dealership is an opportunity to get this shot. So it just takes all the dumb stuff out of it, right? Everything I taught you before, you don't even need to know it, as long as you follow this rule. Because this is the right way to do it, and you can't mess it up. And what's on the other side of windows, generally? A very attractive looking background. The cars, the rest of the showroom, people milling around, you know what I mean? So 100%, if you want to talk to a customer, this is essentially what to do if you get a chance to really pick your poison here. So pay attention to the direction the light's coming from when picking where to stand for your videos. Every building has entryways and windows, and find them and use them. If you're creating a selfie, obviously, you want to have that light pouring onto you. If I'm filming you, I just want to put my butt on the window and have you walk up to me, right? And then the light's going right past my shoulders. Same premise. So the next one's framing the shot. I'm going to burn through this. This is really pretty straightforward. We live in a world now where there's really not a right answer. If you want to go portrait, go portrait. If you want to go horizontal, go horizontal. Keep in mind the medium that you're going to send it to. If you're going to post something on a website, YouTube, something like that, go horizontal. If you're going to make an ad, you're going to make a customer response video, it's optional. You can kind of pick whichever one you want, but there's different ways to set somebody up in those shots. And I'm going to show you one of the biggest differences. Right now, if you just did the math, she's taken up that whole square, 50% of that square, 25% of that square. So she's really taken up about 3 squares of the whole shot. So she's about 30% of the frame. When you set somebody up on a horizontal frame like this, you do not put them in the middle. It's unbelievably boring, and it leaves stuff on both sides, and it's just something more pleasing about seeing them just off to the left or just off to the right. What that does, it creates more space on one side than the other, and you can put something cool back there. And it creates layers into the shot. So you can put a cool car, people working a deal, whatever. So this is the space to kind of give them a little bit of a reveal, and this is where you put the person is just off to the left. If I'm here, and I'm dead on to you, and you have me go just to the right, also have you do just a little bit of turn back, too. You see what I mean? So just a bit. That way I'm not like over here kind of looking away from the camera in a sense. If you go portrait mode, stuck them right in the middle, right? And there is no background to speak of. You're not trying to frame anything else in or include anything else, even though there's stuff back there. But if you look, how much of the shot is she not? Like 80%.
All of it.
Yeah, almost all of it, right? So this would be the one reason, the one argument for doing it portrait style, is that you're really consuming their feed. And when you're scrolling through Facebook or something like that, an ad that's designed like this will take this long to scroll by, whereas one that's skinny like this goes right by. So you're literally getting more acreage on their phone by going with this. And each bit of acreage you own is now filled with more view, right? It's all about name, face recognition. That's the whole point of this game. The video will not do it for you. It's you that sells the customer on how cool you are. The video is just how we reach them, given that they're not already in the store. This is the number one mistake that people make right here. What stands out is wrong about this?
The car stands out, the red car.
Yeah, the red car consumes the frame for sure. The biggest problem with this is just, she's so damn far away. That I can't see if she's excited or not. I don't know if I can trust her. I don't get the chance to make that interpersonal read on her, which is really what we're selling. Damn, I like that guy. Damn, I like that girl. She seems nice, right? That's the currency of this deal. If they're way back here, I don't get that opportunity. And there's other problems that with this that we'll go over here in a minute. But this is the number one thing I see people do. Let's say that the commercial is about this car. So she'll stand with her butt touching the car, and then they'll, you know, try to find a way to shoot them. So the thing to do is this. You set the background up, totally ignoring the person. You look at what you have for light. What's the direction that my light's working with right now? What do I want to have in the background? What cars do I want to have? Whatever. This is basically the same background as that last shot. Once you decide, I like the background. I'm looking at the background. I like that. Then you tell the person to move their feet, and you move them into that shot. You see what I mean? Don't make the mistake of jogging circles around something that you want to film until you find a good angle. Move everything to where you need it to be so that you don't have to think so hard about it. You know what I mean? You move yourself around the background using the light rule. And then when you get the light right, the background's right. Okay, Sandy, come on, a little closer. Perfect, right? That way, it'll always work. The background will work, the person will work, the light will work. So it's just reverse engineering those problems. Did I miss a tip there? No. So, tip, there are three things you can focus on to create outstanding setups for your interviews, and this is the order of them. And you'll notice this is a pretty good example of using them. So, the first one, straight lines. You want to look for, when you're creating a background like this, you want to look for straight lines like this, like this, like this, like this. And the reason is, straight lines, you guys ever remember doing the like, oh look, I can draw a mustache on my way. You guys ever remember doing the like vanishing points where you draw buildings like this? You know what I'm talking about? That's why straight lines look cool. Because as they recede into the background, they create layers and depth in a way that shapes and other objects don't. It gives you that feeling of like, oh, look at that. So you want to look for straight lines. Like if you can find bay doors or, you know what I mean, signage or rails at the top of the ceiling or whatever, that's just one of the things you're always trying to look for. The second thing you're always trying to look for is bright colors. I've moved mop buckets into the background before just for a splashy yellow. You know what I mean? Seriously. So you want to find these little pops of color. That's the other way to judge a great from a good, from a bad background. And then the last one, which is probably the most important because this is what makes the other ones work, is you want to look for depth. Various layers of depth. So if I'm filming you and I'm putting you on this wall, then all I'm getting is a wall and a dude. And it's not that great. You know what I mean? So what I want to see is something that's 8 feet away. Something that's 12 feet away. Something that's 18 feet away. Something that's 30 feet. Like you can see way back there. And part of the reason that that happens is this is at kind of a low resolution because of how we're doing it. But at a higher resolution, you can tell that this is not blurry. This is a little blurry. That's very blurry. And way back there, super blurry. And that blurry, the contrast and different blurrinesses is what gives it to like the watchability. Like, oh, this is very nice, right? And this is also just like a way of taking a picture of your fiance on a vacation. Like these rules all line up, right? So, all right. She had a better mustache than I did for a second. That really gave me a complex. Okay, so that one's an easy one. The next one, how to hold the camera steady. There is nothing more jarring than being moved around on a video. Nothing will make somebody quit, pop, jump out, skip, whatever it is they want out when they do it. And I've seen so many sales guys. For one, if you want to film a car and you point the camera at the car the whole time, there's no frame of reference in the shot to make me comfortable. You see what I mean? So what I get is just the very chaotic, and people are like, I'm gonna go over here and show you the bumper. Bro, they're not gonna be with you by the time you get to the bumper. You know what I mean? Like that, they've already thrown up, they're dizzy, and they're over it. The way to do that in a way that's the same thing but comforting is like this. Oh, I gotta flip it. Now, it's not gonna flip it. So now, and I'll show you, the next thing we're gonna go over is how to hold it like this. Now I'm both the problem, for one, my focus is on cell's at the center of the video. So now if I want to show you the bumper, I can come over here and go, look at this. And then watch what happens when I spit. You see what I'm getting at?
Still in the shot in stage.
I don't move, yeah. I am the frame of reference. I'm the subject, I'm the topic, and I'm the stable anchoring point to watch. So now I can be like, yo, look at this, and it has the big wheels. I know you said you wanted the R-line wheels, but wait till you see the back, right? And you can be alive, you can move, you can go outside, you can come back from a car, hey, I just got your email, I'm so excited, you know? And you can do all these things without bothering them, and it adds life to the video to be moving around, you know? When I do these rant videos for dealers, where I just say stupid stuff, like a dealer might have a $1.75 Coke, and then I want to do a rant video about, like, buy your own vending machines and offer the Cokes for 65 cents. Because then people will, like, internally think, wow, what a great value you get at this place. It's 65 cents. You know what I mean? Like, you're not making any real money off Cokes. So, to me, when I want to do that, I go for a walk. Every time I leave one of those videos, because it makes it easier to watch than just a dude sitting there at his desk pontificating, you know? So that ability to hold the camera steady while being on the move is a huge level up to the game. Because now you can take a boring anything and make it more exciting by just bolting out. And you don't have to worry about how it looks because it changes as you go. You know, you'll look good sometimes, not good the others. And when you can kind of stop and start talking, and when I stop, I tend to just spin. Because it kind of shows them the environment, and I'm there, and it doesn't bother them. But also, and I'll show you when we get outside, if you spin around somebody like this, there's always an angle that looks best for the leg. You see what I'm saying? So when you want to start talking, you can kind of spin till you find that spot. You're like, oh, I look actually really good there. I'll stay here. You know what I mean? So this technique is all based on one thing. Coffee drinkers, everybody, anybody? Have you guys, here, let me just make a point of this here. So I don't know if you've bumped into this problem, but let's say that this is really hot coffee, right? And I want to move quickly from one side of the showroom to another. And you see all the sloshing that goes on? The tighter I hold the cup, and the closer I hold the cup to my body, the more shake I'm going to impart to the cup. So the actual way to carry coffee, if you don't want it to spill, and I could jog across the room, is barely holding, lightly holding the cup and holding it as far away from my body as I can. It's the same exact thing when it comes to holding the phone. You don't need a grip tight lock on the phone. You want to hold the phone very carefully, unless you're doing the technique I'm about to show you. And you want to keep your knees and ankles bent. And you want to move slowly and deliberately, you know what I mean? Especially if you're not in the shop. So always think of the cup of coffee, the analogy, because it helps you understand, I got to keep this phone calm. Same premise as a cup of coffee. Sorry about that. So yeah, hold the camera far away from you, move slow, don't rush, slow is steady, steady smooth. Smooth is gold when it comes to cameras. This is just a really quick tip, but if you're following somebody in a camera, it can be kind of hard to maintain the framing while people are moving around and like doing other things. So one of the tricks you can have is to just meter with your eyes the difference, the relationship of space between these corners. You see what I'm saying? So like, let's say you were moving around and I was filming a commercial with you. Rather than trying to constantly think of it, I just put your head in a certain spot in the corner. Now as you move, I'm just managing those two measurements. You see what I mean? And it simplifies what you're trying to do. And I don't care what happens here. What I care about for the viewer is that her head position is right there. You know what I mean? As long as I get that right, the rest of it's gonna be okay. So that's more of a technique for filming somebody else. But it does work. And then lastly, this is ironic because my wife is the ultimate overcorrector in the car. She drifts right, comes back left. Don't do that with the camera. You don't want to overcorrect. Everybody calling me. Home Seattle's on fire right now. Okay, so whether you're filming yourself or filming a subject, hold the phone far away from your body at or near eye level. For most people, the length of your arm is the perfect distance and it'll help you balance out and avoid those shakes. If you guys want to practice something, the way to hold a phone so that you can do the technique I was showing you before is just like this. So fingers here for balance, fingers on the back, and then you literally just squeeze it. You should be able to see I got white on my knuckles. I'm just making a fist now at this point. What this does, you see the shape? It locks this like a T, or like an L, I guess, in this case, right? So now, I don't have to think about anything, because there's really no angle that I can hold the phone. Keep in mind, the camera's out here, not back here. So it's got a little perspective coming back. There's nowhere I can hold this phone that doesn't have a great shot of me. And by that, I mean this.
Let's say I go up. Let's say I go down. Let's say I go right. Let's say I go left.
You see what I mean? You can't screw it up. And that's what this whole thing is about, is learning some techniques that deliver good results that don't require any of the ring. If it doesn't require a bunch of thinking, then it's gonna be easier to do. You're already trying to think of what you gotta say during the video. You don't need to be thinking about camera mechanics at the same time. So this is the trick. I don't have to look, I don't even have to, I know. I can tell from the way I'm holding it that I got the right shot. And so what it means is I don't have to look at the camera, I can pontificate about the car, I can move, I can do whatever I need to do. This is the key. Locked elbow, locked shoulder, locked fist. The camera should be at an exactly, 90 degree angle, or however you look at that, right? And then you don't have to think about anything. Bang. And that is the key. Between the light, that is the number one tactic right there. Quickly bust these videos out and make them consumable. And it's just a matter of, like I said, keeping your knees bent a little bit and walking smooth. Don't overcorrect, but mostly peg your elbow and your armpit and that wrist joint. You'd be all day, every day. Okay, this was pretty straightforward. So really, these are just things that people don't always see coming. But they will ruin your shot. Gusty winds, steady winds, okay. Like, you kind of white noise that, get used to it. What you don't want is, because that'll take you right out of the video. So on a gusty day, you just got to keep in mind, I need to be between two cars, I need to be in the delivery, or need to be inside. You know what I mean? Because it'll sneak up on you. Service department noises, all that stuff, those are horrible in a video. They don't seem like they'd be bad, but they stand out a lot. And so you always want to keep an eye on that. Generators and stuff like that. Roads in nearby traffic. If you're out on the front line, there's always typically going to be a highway nearby. It's another noise that tends to be distracting. Not all things are bad. Conversation behind you of a customer, somebody honking a car, those are good sounds to have in the background. Overhead music on a TV is not, a children TV or some song that's playing. And then lastly, standing too far from your subject is the number one cause of audio problems. What we talked about when it came to framing the shot, bringing them close to the camera. If I'm gonna actually film another person, I actually have the camera like right here. And I tell them, I know it feels like I'm doing a documentary on your nose, but I'm not. And what that does, A, is eliminates all the problems you have with framing them, as we talked about before. But now my microphone's 3 feet from their face. So if I put her where she was when we first looked at this shot, way back in the back, well, she's 15 feet from me now. I really got to have some kind of technique to get decent audio. But all these phones, if nothing else, have great microphones. But you need to be close enough to it to make it happen.
Sorry, can I get your Masaki?
Yeah,
I'm going to put it on the wall.
Okay, so those are the proximity of the person to the camera. You've seen that come up now in two of these different chapters. It's really important. Getting that right, getting them close enough to you that you can hear them easily and that they fit into the shot and you can see their face and see their actual, reactions and decide if you like them or not. All right, so this is the last bit, and this is really, 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 really important. So when I was new in the business, I'm actually, despite not looking that old, I've somehow already accumulated the 18 years in the car business. And when I was new, I couldn't go on a lunch break without speaking in feature, benefit, advantage. It had to be, hey boss, can I get some chow so I get some calories in my system and have the energy for our guests later? But I couldn't even just say I'm hungry, I'm going to lunch, because they literally made me speak. If I needed a trade appraisal, it was, hey boss, can I get a trade appraisal so I can get an accurate ACV so I can work this car deal and get the customer out here happy? They wouldn't let me do anything unless I spoke in those terms. What I've realized in the last year, since I've been more on the consulting side, in being in dealerships, is somehow this feature benefit advantage thing is not as much of our culture anymore as it used to be. As a salesperson, every single thing you say should somehow create a problem, talk about your specific action and unique problem, unique effort to overcome that problem, but that's how these things happen, and then what experience does that create? So let me give you a silly example. I walked into Auburn Volkswagen one time, and his general manager, Daniel Grisham, who's a good buddy of mine and a good car guy, was in there trying to convince this lady that the computers will break in the Volkswagen. I'm like, what in the hell is the backstory behind this one? So it turns out that she was really close to upgrading, had been a loyal client, would buy from them. He didn't have to worry about her going somewhere else, but she didn't think she really needed to upgrade because her husband was a mechanic. So you see what happened is he couldn't sell her. He didn't have any solutions to her problems. So he created a new problem that only his warranty and his car was the solution to. You see what I'm saying? So it's so important that you communicate with people in this way that it's even like even telling them the car sucks isn't as important as finding a way to solve a unique problem that they have, right? So when a customer's talking, it's constantly got to be you searching for how this feature will benefit them and give them an advantage over a product that didn't have the feature. So everything is feature, benefit, advantage, right? So these 3X scripts that I'm going to show you guys how to make, the point of this is twofold. When you have a problem, I want to show you how to take it apart and talk about it in a relevant way for a customer. That's an obvious one. But secondly, when the camera's rolling, I want to give you a very simple script that you can have an easy time saying that you don't have to think about. Here's what we do. Problem, premise. We either state a premise or state a problem that exists that somebody may not have known about. I'm not going to show you the whole video I made, but I just made a video about our trade appraisal process. And I said, we're not going to just fire some book value at you. We're going to come put a hands-on appraisal of your vehicle. If it's in great shape, if you've got service records or new tires, we're going to know that. And we're going to be able to put that into our offer, whereas another dealership can't. I just created a problem that they had never thought of. Oh my God, we've got a garage kept Buick, and we were about to go trade it in to somebody who was going to pull the value out of a book. Honey, what were we thinking? These guys do hands-on appraisals, right? But if I just said, I do a hands-on appraisal of the car, there's nothing there. If I just say, I'll give you more for your trade, I sound like I'm bad at business, right? But if I explain that I understand your trade in a higher fidelity, and if it's in good shape, I'll be able to reflect that in my offer. Now I'm speaking directly to somebody with a clean trade. So always look for what is the problem. Problem, other places do book values. Solution, we work our butt off to overcome that problem and know more about your vehicle. Call to action, if you want a great deal and a great deal on your trade-in, come see us. So all of these, I'm gonna show you some examples. Problem, effort, call to action. So problem premise, let's say that this is about great trade-in values. I actually just did this one. So yeah, you have a trade-in? We'll do the extra work. It's all about the work. It's not. This doesn't just happen. You know what I mean? If, don't say to the customer, I want you to have a great experience. Tell them what you do. I do this, 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 and this so that you have a great experience. This block is always describing a unique amount of effort that you apply to solve a problem that they may not have even cared about. Then you just tell them what to do. The reason this matters is when you get in front of that camera and you state the problem, everything else is downhill. Pretty easy from there. Problem. Most dealerships, they treat you bad. They're really disrespectful with your time. I mean, are you gonna forget what to say next? I won't treat you bad. I respect your time. Are you gonna forget what to say next? So if you want someone who respects your time, come see me, right? It simplifies everything. By the time you spit the problem out, you're already jogging downhill. Everything else that you would say is intuitive to say. If you try to memorize some long spiel about other stuff, now you're purely relying on your memorization. What you want to rely on is your ability as a salesperson to just talk on your feet. So when you confidently state the problem and you open the video up with the right energy, the rest of it writes itself. So that's why understanding how to structure these is so important. Let's say that you wanted to highlight a new vehicle. What could be a problem that I could create to make an Atlas sound exciting?
Space.
Space, right? So the problem is if you're interested in an SUV, you're probably used to settling in order to get anywhere with 7 passengers. But you never have to settle again with the 2019 Atlas. Why? What did we do? What's so important about the Atlas? The unique effort. The Atlas was designed not to drive like a passenger vehicle. You load it down with 7 passengers. With all-wheel drive, amazing balance, and plenty of room, this SUV has to be driven to be believed. So the effort here is basically in the design. We've designed that. We've engineered that problem out of the vehicle, right? Like, that's our unique effort. Call to action, but just a few clicks below, you can schedule any time that works for you and come drive this car and decide for yourself if you agree, right? Boom, too easy. And then the last one, they had a local casino for one of my clients. It's like right down the road. So you have to follow me on this one. So this is the problem. If you're in the market to upgrade your vehicle and you work at the Tulela Casino, we offer employee pricing to all casino employees with a valid ID for the rest of the month. The problem is, I'm playing that ad to you because you went to the casino and were on my website, not because you worked there. So now you're feeling a little bit of FOMO. Damn, so I can't get the employee pricing then, huh? That's the problem that we created. The unique solution, he changes his mind halfway through the ad. In fact, this month we'll extend that offer to anyone who's even been at the casino. Just show up with a poker chip, parking receipt, or even a picture of you inside the casino, and we'll give you the employee This is our unique effort to overcome the problem that we created. Call to action. There isn't a better price available even to the Owens family, but don't forget to bring proof you're at the casino this month or that you work there. Stop by or click the link below to schedule a time and tell us what car to get ready for you, okay? All right, this last slide is very silly, but it's meant to remind you guys when after I leave of how simple this is, and I think it's a pretty unforgettable premise. Okay, ice wisdom, okay? So ice had this down in 1990, and this will help you remember it. If there was a problem, yo, I'll solve it, check out the hook, right? Tell them what to do, talk about the unique effort you'll have to solve it, identify the problem that they have, or build a problem that they didn't know they had. So this will help you take apart any type of video that you want to make, any type of problem that you want to solve. If you don't know, if a customer won't call you back, you already know what to do now, right? We're going to come up with a problem of theirs. We're going to come up with a thing we can do to sell it. We're not focused on the vehicle. We're focused on ourselves. We're going to find the right light, whether that's inside or outside, right? Lock the wrist. Speak with confidence. Set the problem up. Run downhill. Smile like a fool when you're done. It's too easy. And when we're done, and you've done a few of these, at some point, this should be easier for you than leaving a voicemail. And like I said, if you've got a prospect for a customer, why not make a video one time, send it to 100 people, and watch 6 appointments of themselves? Like, there is an easier way to do this. And investing in that and getting those skills, like I said, every time you make a video, the next one's easier, next one's better. So going out and just going, you know what? Maybe I don't know what I'm doing. Maybe this isn't for me. Maybe this is for me. But I'm going to commit to making 100 videos this month. I'm going to make 3 videos a day, or, you know, 4 videos on the days I'm in, or whatever. And just as a goal, a mindless goal, I'm going to make 100 videos. And then in doing that, I'll be 100 videos better than I am now, and I can reassess how interested I am in this. And so at the very least, I would challenge you guys to do that, which is just get in the habit of thinking to yourself, what can I put on camera that would make this customer feel inclined? And understand that what we're selling is just ourselves and the effort that we put in. So like if I'm trying to get somebody back in, I'm walking all the way out to their car, I'm taking an envelope that has their name written on it, and I'm going, Janet, I'm out here checking on your car, I just want to make sure there'd be no surprises when you got in. It even smells good, which I only tell you that because they don't all smell good. And then, you know, walk back in, right? Because what I'm selling is that I'm over here working for you. So you might have only had this much commitment, but I got that much energy. So now you got to be responsible for the fact that I've got a deal jacket, I've pulled keys, I'm out here checking on cars, I'm following up with you. This is how to put glue on somebody that would like to ignore you, would like to not care who you are and what you've done for them, right? So that's what the meeting is about, is just sending your personality to somebody who's not already in the dealership. And then, did you guys say why my DJ revolves it in your head when I said that?
I'm solid there.
I feel like everybody has to say that. Okay, so that's pretty much it. That's in terms of how to make the thing. And then, so what I'd like to do from here is have you guys focus on trying to use some of these techniques. People in the morning class normally did about 3 or 4 of these, and I corrected, you know, okay, let's do this differently. Let's change this a little bit. And pretty much everybody was able to bust one out pretty quick. And so